I've been invited here to talk and also to perform, without which they said, we won't allow you unless you play your flute. So, change. Much has been spoken by wonderful speakers. I've been listening very patiently from the backside of the auditorium, and everyone's point of view about bringing about a change in our society has been really enlightening for me too. But what I'm going to talk today here is how we as a society need to look at Indian classical music and to change our perception to take it to the next level. In this age of digital world, there have been very many pluses and negatives, positives and negatives of this wonderful technology growth. As a musician, I was born in and brought up in a Hindustani classical musical background, and my father was a very eminent Bansuri artist. So I practiced flute from childhood. I used to carry the flute to my schools, and not only because I was obsessed with that instrument, but also to impress my friends. So that's how the journey began, and as it used to happen with many children, I eventually ended up in an engineering college, and I finished my engineering, and then I came to Bengaluru in search of a job, and I was lucky enough to be offered two jobs at the same time. But before I couldn't even decide whether I wanted to pursue a career in engineering, I was already making music with legendary music directors like Hamsalekha and Raja Nagendra and all of them. So I was really fortunate to be associated with them. Mind you, that was a different kind of music from the kind of music that you hear now. And live musicians and single takes, many rehearsals and all that. Now, what happened during this transition phase was that I realized that my calling was for classical music, because I grew up listening to classical music. I heard all the maestros, and my matinee idol was Ustad Zakir Hussain, the great tabla maestro, and that is why a similar hairstyle. So I am really fond of his, and I think he was one of those catalysts who brought a huge change in the perception of Indian classical music. See, even nowadays, when I talk to a lot of youngsters, they have a feeling about Indian classical music, whether it's Hindustani or Carnatic, that the alap or the improvisation of the raga, the introduction of the raga is so boring that you fall asleep. But what is more important to understand about our music, which has hundreds of years, the tradition, is that it has got all the elements that is much needed for a human mind or a human soul. It can relax you, it can give you a lot of peace, but at the same time, the music also has so much of energy in it that when the performer transforms that energy into the audience, you feel elevated, you feel happy, you feel joyful. And to put it in a layman's term, I would say, especially performers like Ustad Zakir Hussain, Pandit Ravi Shankar, Pandit Bhimsen Joshi, they amalgamated all these beautiful nuances of Indian classical music into their performances to an extent that you could actually see headbanging stuff also in Indian classical music. So the youngsters who were running away from Indian classical music to a great extent were brought in to the classical auditoriums. But what changed beyond 90s, I guess, or early 2000s was this advent of internet. Two things happened. One was that Indian classical music and all the recordings were freely available for everyone to listen to. And the other flip side was even the lesser known musicians, or I wouldn't say less qualified musicians, they started to come up. And I say that is the flip side to a certain extent, because what was traditionally, you know, very spiritual music began, it began to, you know, they tried to entice the audience with smaller goals. For example, the most basic question any student comes to me who wants to learn in my academy is, how much time will it take to play a film song? So that has been the goal, you know. Learning an instrument or learning a music has been brought down only to play film music. But what we as classical musicians want to promote is that the ragas, the talas, the shastra that has been there for thousands of years has much, much more to give, much more to offer than just a few notes. Yes, I do play film songs. I have played for many film songs myself, and I also play many film songs composed by others during my performances. But the aim there has been to popularize Indian ragas through these well-known compositions. So that, I think, was one of the changes that I brought into a flute performance when I started my own band and my own TV show. That there is a need, even now, and there was a need back then, 10 years earlier, that people should identify our Indian ethos, the Indian tradition. I traveled all over the world. I picked up so many flutes that were prevalent in various civilizations. What we should understand is, especially the Bansuri, the flute that we see, has been there for almost 5,000 years. Lord Krishna. So we can relate to it directly. But because of this internet and so many other things, the people who are really capable of, they try to restrict themselves to something very small. This generation, I have seen that they are more capable than the earlier generation. They can pick up very fast, and they can remember so many things. They can, and they are really, really very well equipped. But what the need of the hour, I think, is to look at what our tradition has. And I fear maybe 30, 40 years down the lane, the whole world will think Bollywood is the tradition of Indian music, which shouldn't happen. I know it won't happen because Indian classical music has been there for many, many years, and it will continue to stay. But I think when there is opportunity, it should grow. It should become one of the mainstream music forms of our country. Everything you compare is dependent on Bollywood. The ideas, even the way lifestyle, everything. Everybody has a, you know, eye on what is happening in Bollywood. But at least for music, I'm sure if the classical music and the audience for the classical music grows, then the Bollywood music or the sandalwood music, whatever, all the film music will improve. What is happening right now is, in the name of mass and not class, because classical is always considered class, and that is probably one reason why I have been kept away from Gandhinagar or sandalwood. I've been doing small collaborations and some work in Gandhinagar or sandalwood, so to say. But I think that line should go, you know, they should merge. The classical music or the foundation of classical musicians are so strong that they can actually think in various forms. For example, I performed with a rock band in Holland called Bluff. They still are number one. And it was all distortion guitars, metal music, and I'm there standing with a bamboo flute and a huge audience, like 10 or 12,000 people. And amongst that chaos, this flute piece, that became the highlight of the entire festival there. So that concert actually made me think, and that idea of trying to bridge the popular or the so-called happening music can be merged with our local traditional music. So my goal or my aim has always been to popularize what is very sacred and very traditional. And so I have done a lot of experiments, and some of them was to imbibe techniques that are prevalent nowadays in Western music, of harmonies, of chord structure, and bring them into Indian classical music to make it more contemporary. I use drums, I use keyboards along with my main tabla and Indian instruments, but I use it in a way that it complements and it doesn't disturb the ethos or the therapeutic value of Indian classical music. Because ragas have been tested, time-tested, that they create whatever effect you desire out of them. Having said all this, I definitely feel that there are still many musicians who are really, really capable of taking this to the next level, Indian classical. Not that it is now in a bad shape. In fact, when I began my career, the classical music then was much in a leaner phase than now. The money, the fame, everything is higher. But when I see what these young singers who have sung for a couple of films or have done a few shows, think that they have arrived, the superstardom that they get, the same thing the classical musician doesn't get, or the student of a classical music doesn't get. That disparity, I think, should go. And I think this is kind of a platform where I can share such ideas, and I'm sure all the young minds can think about it. When you are thinking of a change in a society in a much larger way, also think about our tradition and our traditional music. Now, speaking about the changes that I think I have brought in my music, you must be observing this huge locket. So I picked this up in Spain, and I use them in my shows so that people, they get excited. Okay, this is a different kind of a sound. So, flute per se it's a wonderful instrument. So, if you go back in history and look at the various flutes, then we have various civilizations have had this wonderful instrument. In excavations that were made in China and Egypt, they found flutes made of bones. And when I participated in the World Flute Festival in Argentina, I saw all these flutes made of stones, made of bones. Of course, I didn't play the flute in bone. I didn't like to touch it, but it was nice to see. And so flute has been an integral part of various civilizations. It's, even in the tribal music, the flute, this is one flute that I picked up. If you observe, there are no holes here. It's just a bamboo, right? But intelligently though, the tribal people have fitted a small ring here. So when I rotate it, it creates music. It might not be audible, so but this is the kind of technology or music that was used by tribal people to tell someone very far away that someone is coming be careful, or some animal is going to attack, or whatever. So the messages were dependent on the ragas or the tunes that were produced by this flute. So generally, when I make an entry into my concert, I go like this, so that people move around and give me space to play. So these are all that flutes that have come in our folk janapada anta kannadadalli heltivi. So these are the bird flutes or the kogile flutes that I have used in many recordings. And basically the flutes are made of bamboos, as you all must be knowing. So the Hindustani flute is of this size, and it creates a bass sound. That's a very brief glimpse of a Hindustani style. And this kind of a flute generally is used for Carnatic music. The same pitch, but higher octave. I forgot to mention about the things that I have incorporated in my playing. One of the recent things that I've done is what is actually a folk from the folk traditions of India. There's a shank or a conch player in a temple in Mangaluru. He can hold the note of of the shank for almost 40 minutes without breaking. So what he does is he actually stores the air in his cheeks, and he uses that as a reservoir while he inhales through his nose. So there is continuous supply of air. So he's exhaling and inhaling at the same time at one particular point, which we won't realize, and so therefore he can hold the note for a long time. And the same technique has been is being used by Western musicians as well. And one of the legendary saxophone players, Kenny G, has a world record, Guinness World Record, for holding a note for 48 minutes. 48 minutes, one single note. So this is a new edition that I have brought, and I'm not trying to create a record, because I'm trying to use that to enhance my music. So I'll just give a small glimpse of how it I use that technique, and it is called circular breathing. Thank you. So thank you so much. There were many other instruments that I wanted to play, but time is running out. So thank you for giving this opportunity, TEDx Global Academy. And thank you all for listening to me. Hope you have a wonderful session today. And keep thinking about what I said about Indian classical music and musicians, because the next generation of our citizens, we need to look at preserving and promoting Indian classical music. Thank you, one and all.